Mini chapter 120, Bridge to the Imagination Thief, Resolution. In a daze of grim ecstasy, the Jaymi beast climbs back down the tapering framework and rejoins Scorpio and Amber at the tower's base. The three beasts converge in an inward-facing triangle, their arms around one another's shoulders and their foreheads touching. They stand there together for many moments without speaking, Amber's eyes remaining open and the others resting closed. At the sound of distant engines in the sky, the triangle drifts apart as the trio look up and along the span of the Hollywood Hills. Those helicopters that were circling over Stone Canyon are now nearer, having already curled east over the hillside chateau of Beverly Park North, perhaps as far as Coldwater Canyon or thereabouts, aiming spotlights onto the slopes as they circle. It won't be long before they approach Mount Lee, where those spotlights will inevitably pick out Dud's corpse lashed atop the transmitter tower. Peering upwards in alarm, the Jaymi beast is about to speak when Amber forestalls him and sets off up the tower. Amber, calls the Jaymi beast, stoops to grab the cable-cutting pliers from the ground and holds them up towards him, for the rope. Amber glances down, takes hold of the pliers, then resumes pressing on up the framework with those metallic-seeming blonde spider movements of his. The other two watch him recede skywards, almost to the top of the structure, where he sets to work with the pliers, extricates Dud's corpse, drapes it over his shoulder, and sets off back down. By the time Amber and Dud are at ground level again, Scorpio has gathered up all the severed rope fragments and other traces from underneath the tower. Then, through the hole in the chain-link fence, three beasts and one corpse sneak out of the transmitter compound and back down the scrubby slopes of Mount Lee to the car in its hiding place at the top of Mulholland Highway. Half an hour later, the Jaymi beast exits the Harbour Freeway onto Century Boulevard, then travels five blocks west and four blocks south to the motel by the vacant lot. There, with the utmost speed and discretion, Amber and Scorpio push Dud's corpse out from the back seat onto the grass verge beside the back of the motel. No witness has been present as the car slips away down West 104th Street. But whenever the cops do come to find and identify Dud, it's a fair guess they may conclude that his unknown assassin was probably delivering payback on behalf of some local gangster for the recent desecration of those corpses when they were stolen from neighborhood funeral parlors and dropped into the wet concrete foundations of the Righteous Gun cockpit in that outrageously disrespectful publicity stunt by Bangdad Games. The car slips away east, then eases back onto the freeway, joining the fast lane northwards to Hollywood. In his study in the house on Electra Drive, Jaymi Peake lifts his attention out of his three beasts, leaves it hovering over the moving car, and sits there with a shine of exhilaration in his eyes and a confusion of thoughts and emotions inside. Three quarters of an hour later, his phone pings. Checking it, he sees the car has arrived outside. He buzzes open the front gates and garage doors while it drives in through the courtyard and into the garage. Another ping on his phone. A text message from Herb. Hey, Jaymi, they're hanging well. Meeting Ashley at the Silver Lake Bar for several drinks tomorrow evening at 8. Fancy joining us? He smiles, thinks for a moment, then texts back. You bet. See you there. Through his open study door comes the sound of his returning beasts downstairs. Later on, around midnight, if a watcher were to be hiding in the shadows at the far edge of Jamie's middle terrace, peering through the windows at events inside the warm-lit study, then they'd be curious to see the greatest throng of incarnated beasts ever assembled in that room, no fewer than seven, all slowly converging towards his main computer monitor, chatting among themselves, in words that the observer would not be able to hear from across the terrace. Each beast, in turn, would then be seen to approach the monitor alone, before climbing up to squeeze and slither into the screen and vanish back into Jaymi's games software, where their respective in-game future awaits. Throughout this process, each beast would be observed as having an aura of peace and serenity, almost as if embarking on a long-awaited homecoming. Such a watcher would register Jaymi Peake sitting in the study, alert but relaxed on the sidelines, while the screen of the computer monitor would swallow first the Jaymi beast, still carrying the gun he shot Dud with, then in due course Amber, then presently Scorpio, and then the Platinum Raven at her majestic leisure. Tiptoeing across the terrace to the open study doors, piqued by curiosity to eavesdrop on what each beast might be saying, such a watcher would be just about in time to catch Kim's parting comment to Jaymi. You know, Just sometimes, when I've peered deep into the fabric of life, behind the inanimate structure of things, I believe I've caught glimpses of it, beyond the bars of matter. Yes, I could almost be certain that at long last, I was actually contemplating the bear in the machine. And with twinkling eyes, as Jaymi laughs, Kim climbs through into the imagination thief and is gone. Evelyn is meanwhile in the midst of some chatty anecdote to Shigem. I'll tell you the rest in a minute, she says, reaching up to grasp the edges of the monitor, because we're both headed to the same game as Kim. But basically what happened was that she gave me this whole pull-up-the-ass routine about her dog needing a passport. I said, what are you talking about? Of course it doesn't need one. And she said, but it's a poodle. I said, okay, Swivelpuss, why are poodles so special? Then she called me a frizzy bitch, so I said, well, I'm sure your funeral will be a thoroughly tasteless affair, but quite a giggle anyway, so it shouldn't matter too much. Okay, Shigem, hold that thought, and I'll see you on the other side. And with a quick wave to Jaymi, she climbs in and vanishes. Shigem approaches the monitor, the last remaining beast in the room. He turns with affection to look at his creator. You've been a bit ignored, haven't you, sitting over there? He asks, and Jaymi nods. Oh well, continues Shigem, I'll leave you with this, in case it helps. Whenever life gets a bit much and I'm in danger of coming over all unnecessary, I just think of pineapple upside-down cake. As soon as I think about it, all is well with the world. I mean, isn't it the coolest, how it tells you all about itself in its actual name? And how adorably sweet and lovely, back in those caveman days or whenever it was, that while everyone else from the cave was out somewhere killing other people from other caves, there was one little queen like me who decided it was so much more important to stay back home alone in the cave and invent pineapple upside-down cake instead. I know just why she did that. He climbs gracefully up to the monitor, grabs its edges with a flourish of strength that causes his bangles to jangle in the quiet of the study, and glances back at his maker one last time. I'd also like to point out that when it comes to fruitcakes, being heavily fruited is not the same thing as being overfruited. Bye-bye, Jaymi. Shigem's warm brown eyes flash the most beautiful smile his creator has ever seen and perhaps will ever see. Then he's gone, like his companions before him, all sealed into their allotted games forever, never again to run wild through the danger and mess of meat space. And so it is that these seven beasts are born into the upcoming worlds of the Imagination Thief, the Platinum Raven, the Host in the Attic, Apricot Eyes, and Hallucination in Hong Kong, from their respective origins here in the house on Electra Drive, the house on Zeus Drive, the house on Jupiter Drive, or the Melrose Avenue building. Jaymi Peek looks around the newfound stillness of his study, and a luminous sense of peace expands throughout the room, allowing his mind to breathe clearer than it ever has since he entered this house a few short months ago. A little of this peace doubtless arises because, by sealing the beasts forever into his games, he has just consolidated his escape from being identified as the cause of Ashley's and Dud's deaths. For in addition to having managed to avoid any known association with their murders so far, he now has a further safety net. To wit, neither perpetrator nor murder weapon remains to be found, at least in meat space, which tends to be where the LAPD restricts itself to. But his sense of newfound inner peace also derives from something wider than such practicalities, vital though they are. It stems, too, from this final completion of his seven beloved beasts' creations, each of them born as his response to one or other of Bangdad's newsfeeds, but also embodying a particular spell of the most urgent magic he knew how to spin from within himself. Collectively, they are the best contribution he can make to a world that would seem to have been designed to facilitate the likes of Ain't They Freaky instead. They are the highest quality way he can find by which to integrate himself into the world as it is, to find a home for himself beyond the steel and glass of this house on Electra Drive. Now that his five game worlds are on their way to commercial release, he can feel their casts of beasts panting at their leashes, impatient to start their own journeys, to spring out into those game worlds, to run there in pixel form forevermore on screens around the globe. In Jaymi himself, however, the feeling is rather that of having arrived abruptly home at the end of some gigantic odyssey. He senses the upswing inside him of a new capacity for insight into the world, of a kind he could never have guessed at had he not travelled such strange paths to get here. How many contacts he has in the world, and how known he is to so many for his games, both of which tallies will only increase from now on. And in that context, how striking is the aloneness he feels in his work. Yet this sense of aloneness isn't quite true, or is only a part-truth, because the worldly connections that are most meaningful, most highly charged, and most valuable to him are precisely those made by dint of his game creations going out into the world, including when these creations are engaged with by people who have never met him, will never meet him, or are not even yet born. Through connecting with his games, many unidentified people will feel less alone for consuming such expressions of his own feelings and visions, even after he's dead, and despite his having created these expressions in the solitude of his houses here in the Hollywood Hills. For him, that is among the most distilled human connections available. Moreover, the world is now different from before. For one thing, the whole poisonous machinery of Ain't They Freaky is destroyed for the present. Its inventor has been assassinated by Jaymi via the Jaymi Beast's trigger finger high above Mount Lee, an act of grandly destructive creation that Jaymi feels almost as grateful for achieving as he feels for being able to create any one of his beasts. His own truths have thereby taken on Bangdad's lies and conquered them, firing out a chime of light and sending a starburst of zeros zinging in all directions around the curve of the planet's surface. Plus, his own five game worlds are all set to flame into permanent life. Magic and enchantment, mined out of dead things. He sniffs, becoming aware of the scent of a bonfire drifting in through his terrace doors from somewhere across the Hollywood Canyons, most likely tended by a gardener at the edge of some hillside estate like this one, and a memory floats back to him. He closes his eyes, trying to grasp it. Yes, years ago. Woodlands at dusk in the late summer, somewhere on the outskirts of Omaha, Nebraska. Nervous on the group's edge, a 16-year-old Jaymi plays a violin, and the liquid magic of his music is delighting his audience. An end-of-summer hour near the end of all their childhoods. This moving image of him and his audience flickers and slows, as flames from the bonfire flare high, roaring up soundless to obscure the scene. Then they die back to reveal him anew. An hour after his audience was banished, there he remains, in the dark of the clearing, a lone violinist, playing music in the woodlands, as if for all time. He reopens his eyes. He looks around his silent study, so recently filled with the excitable chatter of his seven creations in their final minutes of being flesh and blood. Now that the Jaymi Beast and all his companions have been laminated into their game worlds, destined to remain locked into pixel form forever to be played by future gamers, how poignant it is to reflect on what the Jaymi Beast felt during the brief period he was at large in Meatspace. Throughout all the urgency and drama of his mission to Mount Lee with the others, did the Jaymi Beast feel like a beast, as opposed to a human? Deep inside the Jaymi Beast, was there, in fact? And somewhere inside himself, Jaymi Peak smiles. At last, he can resist the temptation no longer. He jumps up, strides over to his main computer monitor, and fires up the world of the Imagination Thief. From a black screen, the three words of the game's opening title fade up, stand for a few seconds, then fade back down into black, before the first scene begins. "Are you ready for this?" calls Raven to me from the corridor outside my office. "Don't forget, we're pressing the button tomorrow." I sink back in my chair, my feet resting on my cluttered desktop. "Oh, I'll remember, thank you." "Okay then, good night." The main door hisses and clicks shut after her, muffling her steps across the stone floor of the outside lobby where a lift bell rings. To my left, the sun sinks over the Hudson River, turning its water into twinkly pink vertical strips between the towers of Battery Park City.